Welcome everybody to our second workshop in the series. We're going to have a look at SketchUp tonight and take you all through the basics. And yeah, so I'll hand you over to Elena.
Hi guys, welcome. So yeah, I'm just going to go through SketchUp. You can either watch it and take notes. I think some people did that last week, or you can do it along with me. In the chat on the webinar, it will take you to a WeTransfer link. There's a couple of files in there, including a base file and a CAD plan. If you're wanting to join along, I would recommend going and grabbing those. As you do that, I'm just going to take you through some of the key things about SketchUp I've typed up for you. So it's a little bit different to CAD if you've ever worked in the 3D CAD. To orbit the model, you're going to hold down the middle mouse button, the scrolling one, and just move it around. To pan, it's the same, but you're going to hold down Shift. Zoom in and out, it's just the scroll button. And to copy objects and things, it's just M. And then it's a different command in Windows and in Mac. I'm on a Mac right now, but I'm used to working in Windows. So it's Control and M, and like hold down the mouse to move in Windows, and Alt on a Mac keyboard to kind of have the two there. Some of the good shortcuts to note are Rotate, which is Q, E to erase, R for rectangle, T for tape measure, P for push pull, S for scale, L for line, C for circle, B, which is the paint bucket, and M for move. So you kind of pick those up quite quickly. They're all on the top toolbar of SketchUp as well, but it just kind of saves time when you use the shortcut keyboard commands. Some ones that I've added as custom, which I'll show you how you can do that, is you go Window, Preference, or Shortcut, and you can add them yourself. So these are the tools that I find that I use quite commonly. So to click hide, so when you're in a group and you want to hide the rest of the model and just focus on that group, I've set that to H. To group things, I've set that to G. Currently, the G command on default SketchUp is to make components, but we're not really going to go into components because I don't think at this stage you really need to worry about those, but groups are way more important. So that's, I've changed that to G. Offset things are O, and paste in place is just N. I find that easier. It's just one of the keys that are next to move, so it's quite easy to use that when you're copying and pasting things. So yeah, if you've got those things downloaded, I'll just take you into SketchUp. So this is what the base template looks like. It's just a standard floor plan taken from CAD. I'll show you when we go into the top floor how you can import CAD drawings into SketchUp. But I'm just kind of similar to last week, I'm going to assume that some people have already used this at least a little bit. You may have had workshops or tutorials at uni with Richie. I'm not going to go over like the basics. I'm just going to kind of take you through how I would model this house. So this is just, I'd like to say a basic floor plan. It's actually quite a fancy house, so I'm not going to use the word basic. But just to run you through kind of the floor plan so you can see what it looks like. This is the entranceway. You kind of have your little closet for your coats and shoes and things. You can go up the stairs here, down the stairs there to the basement. You have another little closet space and a powder room. You have a large open plan, living room, kitchen, pantry cupboard, a space for a breakfast nook or an office. Then you've kind of got a nice little glassed area, which could be a dining room as well. Back here into the mudroom, which I worked in Canada, we called them mudrooms, but they're essentially utility rooms that take you into the garage, which is here. There's also an entrance to a bathroom and a bedroom, which could be a master suite. And then on the top floor, fairly standard, you come up here, you have look down to below with a bedroom, bathroom, giant closet, another bedroom, another bedroom, another bedroom. So yeah, just a pretty, not standard house, because it's quite fancy, but just a house that we're going to build in 3D today. So you'll probably notice that some of the measurements, if I like measure this wall, they're really strange. You can see in the corner it's 279.4 millimeters. So when you're working on your own projects, you'll probably find that you're gonna have round numbers, but this is a CAD plan that I worked on in office that I've simplified a little bit. So it is in feet and inches transported back to metric. So that's why the numbers are really strange, but we'll ignore them. It doesn't really matter at this point. So yeah, we can just jump into it, I guess. So to basically to start is we're wanting to get the outline of this floor plan, which I've made into a group, but we're just going to ignore that group and we're just going to draw in the space. So the way that I would start a project is to get the floor planes in. So what you're going to do is you're going to hit the L command or the pencil, which is up here. Unlike CAD, you don't need to click enter or the right click of the mouse. You can just click the keyboard and it takes you.
scroll down shift.
So that just ensures that you get a straight line and you're not kind of just missing it by a little bit, because you don't want wonky walls. So I'm just going to go ahead and draw around the floor plan. So just bear with me. So you can zoom in to make sure that you're hitting it, but usually it will go green or purple when you're at the very corners. So hopefully once you've drawn all these lines, it should create a flat face for you to be able to create the floor plane with. So this is a test of truth, hopefully. Yep. So it should close it like you would in Paint, Microsoft Paint. When you kind of close it, it kind of creates a nice face there. So that's going to act as our face and our floor plane. So you're going to go ahead and triple click it. So that selects everything. And then you're just going to make a group. So you can right click, make group, or if you've set up the command, you can go G. So you can see a nice little box around that, and that makes that into a group. So when you work in it, that's it solidified. You don't need to worry about anything else in the model, because SketchUp has an issue, not an issue, but one of the things, when you're not in groups and you just have multiple planes, if you try and move one, it moves the whole model and stretches walls in crazy ways. So the more groups you have and the more times you kind of collate different things, the better, because it makes it a lot easier to edit. So say that this is our floor plan, but we want to move this, make this like a couple meters bigger. It's a little easier to do it when it's in a group instead of when it's all just out in the open. So that's our floor plane there. So what we're going to do is you're going to hit P, which is the push and pull, and that's this command up here, and you're going to bring it down, I don't know, let's just say half a meter, which is 500 millimeters, and that creates the floor plane. So to create the walls, you can either do the same thing again where you draw along, but what I would do is I would copy this plane, X out the group by hitting the escape button, and that takes you back out of all the groups. You're just kind of in the model plane now. Then you're going to edit, paste in place, because if you just click paste, it can just drop it anywhere. But when you paste it in place, you know it's going to paste where you need it. And I've just set that command up as N. So once I've copied that, I'm going to turn this into another group. So it's separate from the floor plane group. It's its own group now. And we're going to go into there like so. And then what I'm going to do to kind of create the walls is I'm going to offset, not like that, offset by clicking the O command or this button up top corner here. And you're just going to drag it out. So you can type in the numbers if you want exact wall thicknesses. But if you have it on your CAD drawing, you can just drag it out to here. So I hide the rest of the model there. You can kind of see now you have the floor plane and the wall plane. So I'm just going to go ahead and delete that. So we're left with just the walls, which is quite handy. So now what I'm going to do, same as the floor plane, I'm just going to push that down for 500 to match the floor plane. So we have that like that. And then I'm just going to bring the walls up just a sort of standard floor to ceiling height of 2400. And as you can see now, that's us with both the floor plane and the ground floor walls. So hopefully if you guys are doing that along with me, I'm not going too fast, I can't tell. But yeah, as I said, if you've got any questions or you want to ask anything, because I'm going, just fire it in the chat and Glenn can kind of interject and maybe get me to slow down, because I might be going really fast. But yeah, that's that. So the next step, what I'm going to do is going to add the next floor up. So what we can do is we can copy the floor plane that we already have by hitting M on your keypad or move, which is up here. And then you're going to hit Control or Alt, depending which program you're using. So I'm in Windows, I'm going to hit Alt. And what that does is that essentially copies it, like duplicates it. Okay. So let me do that again, I lost that. If you hit the upwards key on your keyboard, that constrains it to the up-down axis. Is that the Z axis? I don't know. And we're just going to align the bottom, which is basically would be the ceiling, to the top of the wall, like so. We should have a base plane. So now we basically need to get our upper floor. So just if you guys are doing it along, you can kind of take this time to catch up. Or I'm just gonna show you how you would import a CAD plan. We're gonna import the top plane. So this only works in SketchUp Pro. I think if you've got the normal SketchUp, it doesn't allow you, at least the last time I checked, it doesn't allow you to import CAD plans on a normal SketchUp. It's only SketchUp Pro, which you can download the 30-day free trial, refresh your emails, get a 10-minute free email and get a new one next month. There's also versions, if you're tech savvy, you can find versions online, but you didn't hear that from me. So we're gonna go into import, which is up in file. And it should open up here. Probably should have cleared my documents before I did that. So you're gonna find your CAD plan, which you would find if you're doing it with your own project, it would be in your whatever relevant folder that you'd need. And you'd import that by clicking on it. You don't really need to worry about model units and things, because if you're drawing in CAD one-to-one, SketchUp's also one-to-one, which is really handy, but it does change things if you are working in different units. So say that you're master planning and you're working in meters, you need to just make sure that you're importing it. But honestly, you don't need to worry about any of that, to be honest. So just click that and click import. And you just ignore all that. And it should import. So because I'd already set this drawing up, it's imported where I need it to be. But if you're importing your own drawings into your own projects, it probably wouldn't go where you need it. So what you would do is you'd find a common point on the ground floor plan. So I'm just going to take this post. I'm just going to align it with the ground floor. And then I'm going to move it up, toggling it to the up-down blue plane and just hitting the button here so it aligns with the face. So now you have your top floor plan in place where you need it to be, which is handy. Okay. So then as you can see, some of the floor planes in the top floor aren't the same as the ground floor. So all you're gonna do is you're gonna go into your top floor group and start pushing these faces to where you need them to go. And you're gonna toggle it to the inside. So I'm just gonna go around and double check that everything is aligned. Oh, so when you have a wall that kind of jumps in like that, you don't want to move the whole wall. So what you would do is you draw a line from the inside there, pull it down, and that creates two faces. So it basically slices it, which is really handy. Kind of cantilevers out here. So you're just going to draw down another line, and then you're clicking P, which is the push-pull command, and you're pulling it out to join the wall line there. Okay, so you're going to do the same here. I'm just getting used to the keys because I'm used to working in Windows, but I'm on my laptop, so I keep clicking the wrong button. Okay, so you don't need to worry about back here because back here is a balcony that opens out, so you can just ignore that because that's going to be a walkout. And I believe that's all the walls where we need them to be, like so. Okay, so same as before, what we're going to do is we're in the floor plane group. We're going to copy and paste this plane, this face out. So we're going to hit Control C, X out the group completely, and we're going to paste in place again, which for me is N. But if you don't have it, it would be up in Edit and then paste in place. And before you touch anything, everything will still be highlighted. You're going to go ahead and make that its own group for now as well. Okay. The same as the bottom floor, we're just going to offset, which is O, and we're just going to toggle it to the outside wall, like so. Okay. So then we can delete the face because we don't need that anymore. We just need this section here. And we're going to push down to meet the floor there. Okay. And then we're going to pull it up again, 2400, which is just a standard floor height. But obviously, if you're doing your own projects, that could be whatever size that you need it to be. Okay. So now you have the upstairs floor and the downstairs floor groups. So what you can do is you can triple click it and that will highlight everything in that group. You're gonna control X, which deletes it, but you're basically copying and pasting it, and that's the cut command, which is control X. And then you're gonna paste in place to join the walls here. So that kind of looks a little bit like this. Now your walls will be in the one group, so when you go to edit them, you can hide the rest of the model and just work on the walls. We can clean them up in a minute, but what I'm going to show you before we do any of the cleaning up is how to do the windows. So we're going to move on to windows, which I've kind of put little groups over here just to make life a little bit easier. You can find these in the 3D warehouse, or you can model them yourselves. These are just ones that we used in office along with materials, which we'll come on to slightly later on. So just grab these windows. So what we're going to do is we're going to highlight the door and the window. But you should probably hide the walls first. So when I'm working on windows, I like to hide the walls because it allows you to be able to see where your windows are a lot easier. So if you click on the wall group and you right click, you can click hide and that makes them disappear. But don't worry, you've not deleted them. If you go to view and click hidden geometry and tick that, it kind of hatches them in a little bit. So that shows you the things that you've hidden. So it's really easy to right click and click unhide. But as we're working on the windows, we can just hide those for now and then we can come to those later. So we're gonna move these over here. So I've already made them the correct size, but I'll show you how you adjust them because we do have some different size windows along this wall here. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to move that. You're going to grab the corner and just align the corner where you need it to go there. So if I just kind of scroll down, you can see that it lines up nicely and nicely there. And then another good thing to always watch out is whichever side your door handle is matches your door swing. Because that is something that tutors can pick up really, really easily in crits. You don't want them to start like hammering into you about your door being the wrong way around, because that's happened to me before and that's not ideal. Okay, so you're going to click on the corner and you're going to align it if it wants to align, which it doesn't, right there, like so. So you can see here the windows, which are drawn in plan, line up. And then you're going to do the same, you're going to copy and paste it like so. Okay, so to move these ones over here, you're gonna have to grab them again and we're gonna just rotate them. So that's just copying it in the corner because this is a nice little corner window situation that's happening. You're hitting Q, which is rotate. That took me the longest time to work out that's what the command for rotate was. I used to always just click the rotate one up here before I learned that it was Q, and I was like, why is it Q? But it's just because I think rectangle has the R command. So for some reason, rotate is Q. Maybe there's some weird Latin meaning behind it, but I don't know. So what you're gonna do is, it's on this command, you're gonna want to make sure that it toggles to the blue, because if you toggle it to green, it starts to rotate that on that plane. And then again on red, it will rotate that in a different way. But when you're just wanting to rotate it like normal, it would just be the blue command. And you do that just by like holding onto the top face essentially. So you're going to click that corner, you're going to draw a line, which is an invisible line, to there. So that allows you to say that this is the line of geometry that I want to pivot it on, and you're just going to rotate it. What you can do is you can hold down shift and that would lock it to the next degree, like 90. But then alternatively, you can just type in 90 as well. That there. But as you can see, it's not quite the right size. So how we edit that is, this is a group. So we're gonna double click to take us into the group. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna left to right, highlight that window there. If you highlight the other way, right to left, it takes everything that it touches. Whereas when you highlight left to right, similar to CAD, it just highlights everything that's contained within that selection. So all we're gonna do now is just move that so it hits that line there. So you have to make sure, if I just undo that, you have to make sure that you are highlighting everything, because if you only highlight some things and try to move it, it does some pretty crazy stuff, which we don't want, because that can mess up your model really, really quickly. So you need to make sure that you are highlighting everything that you need to and moving it along like so. Okay. And that works the same if you don't want a floor to ceiling window, that works the same, whereas you can highlight the bottom and move the bottom up like that. So it's not floor to ceiling. I'm just gonna undo that. If you do want floor to ceiling windows, because we're bougie. Okay. So we're just gonna copy and paste that along as well. And we're gonna do it again here. Okay, so as you can see again, this window isn't quite the size that we need it. So we're just gonna highlight. And move it in like so. Okay. Like that. So that's just a really quick way how you can add windows. I'm going to show you how to punch them out of the walls, and then we're going to open up a new file, because what I've done, just to save time, because it will take us forever to go around and do every single window, so I've kind of made another file where all the windows are done for us. I just wanted to show you a couple so we can crack on and get finished building, because we don't have all night, sadly. So we want to grab our walls back, so we're going to hit View, Hidden Geometry, and we're gonna right click and bring back our wall plane. Just the wrong size. So now we have our wall planes. I've just brought that wall in to match the windows because I accidentally extended it a little bit too far. That's fine, don't worry about that. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna hit the R command, which is the rectangle, and we're just gonna essentially draw some rectangles like that. But what we need to do is we need to make sure that we are in the wall group, because it's the walls that we want to work on. So just double check that you're in that group, and that's no problem at all. So once you're in there, you want to be able to see your windows, so you're gonna unhide the rest of the model. And we're just gonna draw a rectangle, which is the size of the window. Use the push-pull command, push it out like so. And you can do that again there. Where you just draw a rectangle, push it through your windows. So you would go around and you would do that for every single one of those windows there. But to save time, I've already done that. So if we kind of close out of that and you go into the WeTransfer file that I sent earlier, it should be called MISC. Whoa. I don't really know why it looks like this. Okay, that's fine. So that's the MISC, that's the new file. But it's all really weird. I've got one weird player. I'm just going to try closing that, just because it looked a little bit funny. So I'm just opening this up again now. There we go, it's a little bit better. I'm not sure what happened to that file there. So as you can see, I've gone around and I've done all the windows in this file, and I've punched them all out for you. On the top floor, you can see there's a different arrangement of different size windows. So usually if you have just a little bit of like architectural thing, if you have things under the windows, they're not really gonna be floor to ceiling. So there is like a dressing room, walk-in wardrobe unit there. So that wouldn't be floor to ceiling, because that doesn't really make sense. And there's also some transoms along the top, which allow them to be operable. So yeah, if you go ahead and open that file, we can start working again. Okay. So now what we're gonna do is we're going to create some of the roof planes to make life a little bit easier. And because it's just the style of the house, this is what in my office we'd call a modern house, which architectural terms in our you'd probably get annihilated for saying that. But that's what we call them in office. So similar as creating the floor planes, what we're going to do is we're going to go just randomly into the top four. We're going to top click the top face. We're going to copy that. Escape out completely so you're no longer in any groups. Paste in place, which for me is the command N or edit, paste in place. And you're going to make that its own group. So we're going to move it up so it matches here. So just a little bit of housekeeping, we're going to have to create that like so and delete those lines. And again over here, because we don't need our roof plane to come all the way out. So. Okay. So then what we're going to do now is we're going to offset that to create some overhangs. So what I would do to make some nice round numbers, we're just going to offset it to the edge of the building. And then we're going to offset that again. And what's a nice overhang? Let's just say half a meter. So you're going to type in 500. And that creates some nice overhang conditions there. Okay. So I like to just clean up the model as I go. It makes life a lot easier when you kind of clean up the lines that you don't need as you go. Alternatively, you can do that at the end, but I just think I find it a lot quicker to do it as I go. So we're just going to raise that. Let's say 500, quite a thick roof plane, but that's fine. And then delete that one line. You can double click sometimes, which won't let you. Okay. Totally unnecessary, to be honest, cleaning up these, but I like the model to be tidy. Okay, so you kind of have something that's starting to look a little like a house. As you can see, the ceiling plane has deleted itself, so I'm just going to go and close that. So we kind of have a basic form starting. Just to add some depth, also, that's another thing I should probably note, is in real life, a flat roof obviously is never fully flat. It does have a slight slope to it, but that's something you know in technical drawings. It's not really something you need to 3D model. There's a lot of sort of technical hacks and things that, of course, buildings have all these different like parts and bits and shit to it, which you don't really need to worry about because it's just going to model up the model. It's just models are mainly visualization tools to be able to see what things look like. So it's okay if they're not technically accurate. So don't worry about sort of low slopes and integrated things like that. It's not really necessary at this point in time. So just to add some little detail to the trim, we're just going to offset that 50. No, we're not. We're going to offset that 100. And we're going to bring it down 50. So that just kind of adds a little bit of oopsie daisies. Depth. When you kind of go on to render it, it will shadow. And make some nice little details there. Then you're basically going to go and do the same for the smaller roofs or porch roofs. So because we don't have the floor plane, you're going to have to go and draw that ourselves. So luckily, if you draw overhangs in your CAD plans, it makes life a little bit easier. If not, what you would do the same as you would a floor plane is you draw along the inside walls and offset out. So we're just going to go draw along like so. And that should create a flip face. You're going to highlight that, click group, go into the group, and just pull that down so it meets the wall there. Which doesn't look right. So obviously, it wasn't drawn right in the CAD plan. So things like that, you can start to see when you put your CAD plans on top of each other in SketchUp or whatever 3D modeling software you use, you can start to see where some of the issues lie, like say the windows don't align properly. SketchUp or any other 3D program is where you can see those errors. So especially in office, that's why I could go up to like whoever I was working on a project with and just kind of be like, yo, you've drawn your windows wrong. They don't align. So it's a great way to see where you're sitting in terms of like how accurate your CAD plans are. Okay, so we're gonna go and we're gonna draw this one as well. Oops. Okay. That creates a nice space like that. And then group that again, just like before, and pull it down like before as well. So it starts to look a little like this. So just to tidy up this corner here in the design, it has overhang with a garage too, garage. So we're gonna just push that along to this line here. You can pull this, but then what that does, if I hide it, it pulls the whole section. So what we want to do to stop that is just draw a line to break up the face. And we're gonna pull and make that join there. And the same again in this section.
Yeah, I always like to sort of bring the overhangs round so they don't just stop at the edge of the wall, because that can kind of create a little bit of an awkward detail. So I hit out, you can see that starts to pivot around like so. Okay, so to add that kind of detail trim again, what I would do, because that's a 360, so when you kind of offset, that offsets everything around that floor plane. We don't really want to do that because then it will go inside the building. So another way that you can draw that detail is if you click move and you duplicate it by clicking Alt or Control, bring that down 50, and then you just, this takes a little bit longer, but you just go around. I don't like that being that big, so let's just make that 50. Pull that out. Realize that I'm like rapidly going through this, so apologies if you come, if you get a little lost. But as I say, any questions, or if you want any follow-up questions after this, don't hesitate to send me a message. I'm more than happy. Ooh, wrong way. More than happy to help. Like so. And then you do the same here. So you'd click the face, click move, and then hold Alt, because if you click move, that starts to move it. So you're gonna hold Alt or Control to duplicate it, bring that down 50, and push the lines out for 50. So it makes it a lot easier when it's round numbers, because it's just a whole lot quicker. So that's that. I would go and do the back, but to be honest, let's just focus on the front to save time. So that's that. Starting to look a little like this. Okay. So now we're just gonna draw the porch. So to draw the porch, we're gonna draw along the CAD lines. Once you've drawn that face, you're going to triple click that and make that a group again, so you can go in and edit that a lot easier. We're just going to bring it down to meet. Don't worry about the gap. I'll show you why we have that gap in a minute. Just down to meet before the foundation. And we're going to bring that down. It's a standard step height, I don't know. And bring that up like this. And then you can push that out, like so. Ooh, what a horrible number. So there we have our stairs, our steps, and we can delete those lines to make that a little bit cleaner. So just to add a little bit of depth on this so it's not very flat, how we would usually do it is, in this project anyway, it was built out of stone with a concrete style slab on top. So what you'd do is you'd have to model that. You would highlight all of those, bring them down for 100 and push them out for 50. So it just adds a little bit of depth, a little bit of detail to your project. And when you go on to render it, if you do go on to render it, I use V-Ray, but you can use things like 3ds Max or Lumion. It just adds a little bit of shadow, a little bit of depth to it, just to make it a little bit more realistic. So that's our porch there. This project also has some posts. So I'm just going to draw a rectangle, which is the R command. Draw that. Group it. Pull it up at the top. And we're just going to copy and paste that over there on the other side as well. So that's starting to look a little bit more like a house. So the next step for me would be to go onto materials. So what I would do for materials is they would have different depths. So when I was in office, we had sort of set measurements for how thick timber would be or how thick stone would be, and that's where these different wall layers are. So they're a really awkward number. So for ease, I'm just going to extrude them 100. Okay. So what I would do is you go into the wall group, because obviously this is where the materials are, and we're just going to extrude the wall out to how thick that we need it. So I'm just going to go and draw lines there. We don't want to extrude this bit. We only want to extrude this plane here. And we're going to bring that out 100 to meet the porch. Okay, and then we're going to do the same on this wall. So I'm drawing a line here. Don't need to draw a line there because I think we're going to make that stone, and there's already a line drawn there, thankfully. So I'm going to pull that out 100. A little bit of depth. To make life a little bit easier, what I like to do is, grab these because they've not been copied over. I like to paint as I go along so I can remember which walls I've extruded and pushed out. So you're going to hit your B command, which either on Mac, which I don't like, it kind of creates these weird pencil things on the side. If you're on Windows, it's going to be a panel on your right hand side, which is a lot sleeker, I find, because there's just a few colors in the pencils. So you're going to click the B command. You're going to hold down either Control or Alt or Command on your keypad, and that kind of creates a little droplet pipette style thing. You're going to click on your material. So I've imported these standard materials that I used in office. You can import them from the internet. You can add them using this here. So I'm just going to use that. Going to go in back into the wall plane, click B, and click on the plane that I want to paint. So I know that I've extruded. Can I close that? Extruded those out. Okay. So this wall here, what I'm going to do is draw a line there. Draw a line down from the window to meet there. And push that out for 100 and paint. Same again here. Pull that out for 100 and paint. Pull that out for 100. So you can, what you can do is when you're extruding, offsetting your walls when you're drafting the wall plane, you can make them the same width as the materials when you're in that stage. But I like to kind of create a blank canvas of just the standard wall size and add the materials to the wall, if that makes sense, because then you can go and change it. So say that you don't like the stone aligning to that wall there, you could align it to the base of the window instead. So it's a lot easier to edit, plane change, create different facade scenarios when all your walls are just like a standard size to begin with. So I'm just gonna draw down, oops. Pull that out for 100 and paint. So now we have our stone walls, essentially, like so. And also what I'm going to do is, so in office, these windows for us would always be 2 foot height. So when we have transoms in our modern, I keep using that word, modern homes, we always kind of did like a 2 foot strip of metal. It just kind of creates a little bit of life to the drawings, to the models, and a little bit of play on different materials. It's always key just to make sure that you are drawing the lines in the right place by making sure they're straight by holding down the shift key. Now that we've drawn those, as I say again, I'm just working on the front. I don't have time to go all through the black back. So I'm just going to click the B command again and the Control or Alt. Get a little pipette, and we're going to paint using the metal colour here. And we're just going to those look black. Okay, like so. So now we're just going to exit out because what we want them to do is we want to make the windows black as well. So we're just going to make sure that we're in black now. And if you zoom in, because the windows are in a group, you can paint the group. So at the minute they're all default white, which is the default plane that SketchUp has. So when everything's the same color or the same plane, you can make them all the same color at once. So all I did there was just click into the group and that changed basically everything that's default in that group to the color that I wanted. So hypothetically, I could change that to orange if I wanted, but I don't. Who wants orange windows? Okay, so that's like that. And then we're gonna go do the same for the, not for walls, the roof planes. Like that. Okay. Okay, so then now the rest, we're gonna just make the timber color. So you're gonna go back into the walls and you're gonna push that out. I would say half of what the stone would be. So I'm just gonna pull that out for 50 and paint. Pull out for 50 and paint, etc., etc. Perfect. So there we have most of our materials. And I'm just going to paint the okay. So then the same over here. Similar to the upstairs, I'm just going to draw a line. Push that out for 100. Push that out for 100. And paint those stone. Paint that top panel metal. Okay. So now we have something kind of looking a little bit like this. What we'd like to do is we sort of added like a, I don't really know what you call it, just like a windowsill, but it's not a windowsill. Just to add a little bit of textural depth. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring that down 50 and pull that out for 50 and paint that. And essentially go around all the windows, or when you have, whenever you have a change of material, it's always good just to kind of create that difference. It just adds a little bit more of like a depth, a little bit more professionalism to your drawings. Because you wouldn't just have like the Tim Burton ending so abruptly, you would have a nice little transition, at least in our projects we did. So you just go around and do that for the metal. And then you'd also do it the same down here. Going to make the ones that are on the stone. Oops. I'm also going to make right there. There we have a nice little house built, essentially. So when you are doing your own project, you'd probably go in and build all the interior walls and things, but this was just sort of like a exercise for the outside. I know I was like really rapid kind of going through that. So I don't know, what's the time? Oh, 49 minutes, that was really quick. Apologies. So I don't know if anybody has any questions or anything that they'd like to know specifically about SketchUp or questions or anything like that. Sorry that I was like super speedy. I'm just so used to using SketchUp on like a daily basis that I kind of know how to do it and I don't think about it. So apologies if you're trying to work along and couldn't quite grasp it or you missed something and couldn't keep up. But as I say, just fire any questions in the chat or just ask me. I don't mind answering any questions. So yeah. See if anyone has anything.
Thanks very much. That was brilliant as well. Give it a couple of minutes to see if anyone's got any questions. I would just mention just now as well, so was recorded again, same as last week. If anyone wants the recording out to do, to have a look over anything, or if there's anything that you've forgotten, or if you just want to watch it again, then give us a message and we will get it sent out to you. We're having a look at the moment at setting up a sort of bank of videos, but we'll let you know when that's available. Are we doing one on V-Ray? Yeah, we're going to eventually do one on V-Ray. So next week's workshop is going to be on InDesign. We're going to have a look at pushing rendering next semester, as well as Revit as well, potentially, just once Richie's covered more with the lower years. So if there's anything else that you think that might be worthwhile as a workshop that you want to know about, just give us a message, or if you want to fire it in just now, and we can recruit somebody for it. But
as Glenn said, if there's any different softwares, I know there's a whole plethora of 3D modeling softwares out there, from like Rhino to Grasshopper, BIM ones like Revit. If you're wanting a workshop on any of those, just let us know and we can try and find someone. Or if you know how to use a software really well and you'd like to do a workshop with us, we're obviously be more than happy to help set that up. Because it's a great way just to teach, because Richie's fantastic and Richie goes over so many things. But as online learning is a little bit different and obviously that kind of stops in the second year, we'd like to try and help pass on all our knowledge that we gain, especially in the upper years. So if there's any programs or any just like styles, anything like that you'd like to know, just let us know and we can try and sort that out for you, essentially.
Well, I don't think we've got any more questions, but thanks very much for coming, everybody. I'll put a message out in the next couple of days about our InDesign workshop next week. So if you all keep an eye out for that, if you're interested. But thanks very much for coming. Thanks to Elena as well for putting on such a good workshop.